Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Kaushal Kishore. I work in with an organization. This is a Government of India organization under Ministry of Communication and IT, Department of Telecom. It is called Universal Service Obligation Fund. We have completed 12 years of our existence. Universal Service Obligation Fund, it is a statutory body which has been created by an Act of Parliament. And the mandate is to provide telecom services in rural and remote areas. So there's the service provisioning part, with a rider that these services are provided at affordable and reasonable prices. So first part is that it is the mandate of the organization, Universal Service Obligation. The state undertakes this responsibility that telecom services in all its manifestation has to be taken to rural areas. Why only in rural areas and why not in urban areas? For the simple reason that world over, there are well-documented situations of market failure. Market mechanism left to market forces alone, these services will not be taken to every section of the society and to every part of the geography. Health, education, and telecommunication, among so many other things. So it is the duty of the government to intervene directly. So this is the mandate. Now, how do we fulfill our obligation and how do we discharge our this mandate? I will put it very simply. 5% of your telephone bill is collected by the government, roughly, not exactly 5%. Not 5% of the telephone bill. There are certain plus and minuses in that, but roughly it translates to that. 5% of the telephone bill is collected by the government as universal service levy. But it is not collected from the customers, it is collected from the telecom service providers. It goes into this fund. Annually, we are collecting around 7,500 to 8,000 crore per annum. It goes to Consolidated Fund of India, and depending on the yearly requirement of fund, provision is made through the budgetary process. So far, the collection has been of around 54,000 crores. 22,000 crore that has been utilized for funding these rural telephony projects. As of now, the potential balance is around 32,000 crore. That is the claim which Universal Service Obligation Fund has over the size of the resource available. So what we have done so far? We started with, in 2002, that minimum one community telephone should be available in each village. That was the period of village public telephone. Then came that bigger villages, they need to have one more community phone. And this was to be fully funded by Universal USO Fund, the capital expenditure as well as the operational expenditure. Then the third scheme was that we should fund rural telephony, provision of individual connections also, whether given through wireline or through wireless. And out of Universal Service Obligation Fund, 88 lakhs telephone connections were given between 2005 to 2010 March. Then came the scheme of provision of rural wireline broadband services. This was the scheme which was launched in 2007. It was based on the recommendation of TRAI. As of now, telecom customers, it is well known. Individual institutions, they are the consumers of the telecom service. But besides that, who are all are the active players. It is the government, if through Department of Telecom, they are to frame the policies. Then Telecom Regulatory Authority of India is there. They have to regulate. They have to generate expert. They have to advise the government that how, what should be the direction of the policy, regulation. And they give directive on quality of service also. That is supposed to be, that is an independent organization, but only for technical matters, for funding and other things, it works under the control of Department of Telecom. But it is another statutory body which is supposed to be independent. And then you have the service providers. So telecom service providers, telecom companies, TRAI, Government of India, DOT, Department of Telecom. There is another body that is called TDSAT, Telecom Dispute Settlement Tribunal. So any dispute between government and the telecom service providers, telecom service providers and TRAI, these disputes are to be resolved, taken in the first go at the TDSAT. So telecom ecosystem in the country consists of TDSAT, that is the tribunal, TRAI, that is the regulator, DOT, and the telecom service providers. Rural wireline broadband scheme, that was initiated on the advice of TRAI, that BSNL, the government PSU in the telecom sector, they have around 28,000 rural exchanges. So these rural exchanges can be leveraged to provide broadband. And the target was that these 28,000 exchanges, we should have one rural kiosk, community access, PCO kind of a thing. And then whosoever wants to have broadband connection in the vicinity of that rural exchange, wherever it can be given, that should be subsidized. So the target was to provide 8 lakh connections. Quality is another aspect. For internet, there is a definition of broadband, that minimum speed, if you can give this much of a speed, then it qualifies to be called broadband. And again, the standards are set by International Telecom Union and that every member country has to follow. So rural wireline broadband scheme, USO fund has so far been helpful in provision of around 5 lakh rural wireline broadband connection and then around 14,000 kiosk. One more year of the scheme is there, and the aim is to take it to 8 lakh connections. Along with that, 2006-07 itself, USO fund to provide mobile coverage to the rural areas, we funded 7,300 telecom towers. Certain blocks were black boxes, areas of darkness, so to say, they were identified. And USO fund gave complete CAPEX, capital expenditure and OPEX for 5 years for the establishment of those towers. And we were instrumental in covering almost 75,000 villages. Last 3 years, we are working on a very ambitious project, that is taking broadband to these villages. The earlier scheme of rural wireline was wherever these rural exchanges are located and their number being 28,000, using those exchanges and their existing copper and provision of wireline broadband. Now it is a different scheme which is far more extensive and in that sense ambitious. India has 6,07,000 villages and 2,50,000 panchayats. In some of the states, all the villages have been declared as panchayats, like in Haryana. Haryana has 13,000 villages, and each single village constitutes a panchayat. For example, Bihar. Bihar has 42,000 revenue villages, but the number of panchayats is only 8,500. But roughly, the big picture is 6,07,000 villages. Out of that, 2,50,000 are panchayats. So far, optical fiber is available at around 6,500 urban locations. So there is a gap. There is a gap between the block headquarter or the nearest urban center and these gram panchayats. So incremental fiber, optical fiber, would be laid, just for understanding, between the block headquarter and to the gram panchayat. As of now, the target is that towards the end of 2016 calendar year, we have to cover all the 2,50,000 panchayats. And that is going to be a real game changer. In the first presentation, it was said that basically, first there has to be supply. Physically, the broadband facility should be available. Then only the question of affordability comes, demand comes. Even if there is a demand and there is no supply, the services will not be availed. So this is an attempt by the government through USOF to tackle the supply side, that yes, let us take optical fiber to 2,50,000 locations, put the electronics at both the end, and thereafter, the expectation is that the services at the customer end, the last mile connectivity, so to say, that there is a very popular jargon in telecom world, last mile connectivity, means who will take this service directly to the customer. It will be done by the existing telecom service provider. Of course, challenges are many. Who will develop the content? What will be the content? How fast it can be done? There is a concern that do we have enough demand to justify this kind of investment? The total investment is going to be around 27,000 crore. So this will consume almost 3-4 years of the whole US universal service levy, which Government of India collects from all the existing telecom customers. So far, the scheme is based on the premise that there will be no dearth of demand. But demand will not materialize on its own, of course. The proper ecosystem has to be developed of the content, service provider, and those who are to receive this. So at one level, the final challenge will start after laying of those optical fiber things. Our rules provide for doing pilot projects also. Since last 2 years, we are involved, of course, in terms of a scale and in terms of experiment, it is not very significant, but we are into a new kind of thing, Sanchar Shakti. It was initiated as part of gender budget initiative of the Government of India in 2011. Essentially, it boils down to using ICT, means mobile telephony, for delivery of what? Delivery of information which is content-wise relevant to these beneficiaries. Who are the beneficiaries? Beneficiaries are rural women. They are organized by organized through self-help group with the help of a local NGO. So this is the delivery part. What information is delivered? The information is, we don't bombard them like real estate agents, which we are subjected to. Of course, certain generic information is given to all. Examples, messages related to health, education, and the whole range of welfare schemes which Government of India and the state governments have launched at the district level. They range from old age pension, scholarship, maternity benefits, then for girl child, something is some of the state governments are doing. So this forms part of the generic information which is given to everybody. After that, we provide by proper customer profiling, profiling of the beneficiary, that can this message help the beneficiary in improving her livelihood? Agriculture, animal husbandry, dairy, goatry, these mandi rates, weather information. Probably all of us, some of us may have exposure to the life in rural India as a, not as a visitor or not as an expert, but somebody. I come from a village, but for the last, for my education and now for work, I live in cities. So city starts growing on you. As simple a thing as weather forecast, if I receive that, if a villager receives that well in time, it saves effort, energy, and most of all, money and income. We had gone to one of the places where we are doing this project, that is in Srikakulam. When I went there, I saw it for the first time, even though initial years of my life was spent in a village, and still I am a villager who lives in Delhi. But somehow you get so acclimatized, or the city starts growing on you, that you don't understand the importance of this weather information. It was something to be seen, to be believed, the kind of good words those rural women had to say about USO fund and the service provider, that if they get timely information about the rain, wind, and then that is a cyclone-prone area. So that saves their livelihood. Mandi rates, it empowers women. It empowers them to bargain. It is an important factor that what they sell and where they sell. So of course, it is not very big number in size, but in terms of learning for USO fund and professional learning for, I think, everybody who has been part of this scheme, that is great. We, 3,200 women beneficiaries in all these five locations, Srikakulam, Pune, Uttarakhand, and now we are about to launch this scheme in Saharanpur and Ajamgarh. I will take just 2 minutes and quickly summarize the lessons of what I learned from the Sanchar Shakti scheme. I used to fancy myself, and probably part of this came because of my background, that probably I understand the problems of rural areas. India is such a vast country. If you talk of urban or rural, most of the time those who claim themselves to be expert, now I'm convinced that more often than not, and unless proved to the contrary, we masquerade as experts. India is too big a country. Whatever is true for Srikakulam district, it doesn't hold good for Telangana. Param Sahib, I was, during elections, I spent almost close to a month in Telangana, Karim Nagar. The culture, the way of living, even the Telugu which is spoken in Telangana is so different from what is spoken in Srikakulam. So even if we allow that all our knowledge about India has an urban bias, within different states and different towns and cities, there is so much of variations, and if you start for any work based on generalization, it becomes probably too general and it loses its relevance. Me and Madam Anita, we had gone for this evaluation of this program to Banaras and thereafter to Ajamgarh. She had so many queries about starting from that Of course, I don't know to what extent us to understand, see, things are so different. Probably, see, comes from that part of the country, and Eastern UP is so different, starting from roads, drivers, condition of the vehicle, the local NGO, then Banaras as a city. It was a great learning for me. I was trying to put things in a proper perspective, and I had to marshal all my knowledge of the history, geography, politics of the last 60 years of that area. I have traveled India extensively, so I could put things in perspective. There is a huge, not huge, there is a hunger for information in rural India. Women and the energy and the level of enthusiasm of those rural women is remarkable. It doesn't get reflected in our mass media. It doesn't get reflected in our television. It doesn't get reflected in our English newspapers. And all of us read only English newspaper. So reality of urban India, does it get reflected? Now I am skeptical even about that. The story of the Ajamgarh, which it was my first trip to Banaras and it was my first trip to Ajamgarh. For Anita also it was first trip. So I was trying to see Ajamgarh through her eyes. And so even block level towns of Andhra, Telangana. Telangana is backward only by South Indian standard. Telangana is not backward by North Indian standard. If you compare with North India, it is well developed. So if you read only English newspaper, you will... which district you have in mind? No, I cannot say that I went deep inside Adilabad, but yes, I did cross Godavari and I went inside. No. Tribal area is different, but if you compare tribal area of Odisha or tribal area, then to probably Adilabad will not fare badly, right?
Yeah, comparing to Odisha, but I think it's pretty bad, even from
Okay, I agree. Adilabad is backward. But I went to Warangal, Warangal, Karimnagar, Nizamabad, and in between Hyderabad and before you reach Karimnagar, there is another district. Some other name. You. No, the road which takes her from, which takes you from. Yeah, yeah. In between Hyderabad and Karimnagar, you pass through. No, not Khammam. Khammam is not. Anyway, what I'm saying that probably the requirement of rural India, we say that we know, but it has to be subjected to the reality test. One. Two, we may have fatigue of over-information, oversupply of information in metros like Delhi, but there is a huge demand. They don't want only information, they want counseling. And the what can be done, possibility of doing, that is tremendous. After returning from Srikakulam, I said that India being union of 29 states, we should have minimum 58 pilots. Then only your data, otherwise India being too big a country, you do small little things in two places and you say that you know about India. No. This was regarding, this is the only exposure which USOF has with area in which US specialize. And this is the limited relation which we have. But yes, as part of our overall thing, we are, whatever we are doing through NOFN, I am sure that in next 2.5 years, it will change the face of rural India. Once these pipelines are laid, there is a general misconception that wireless is not wireless. Through wireless, this is a wireless instrument. Through this, only a small amount of data can be transmitted to a small number of customers, right? there is no substitute of connectivity through optical fiber cable. That is the backbone which has to be developed. So once it is developed and put in place in rural areas, so coverage will not be an issue. My assessment is that after 3 years, other things would become more important. What content is given, who will develop that content, probably how to regulate that, in what direction it has to be developed. Those things would become more relevant post-2016.